In our last message from 1 Corinthians, we considered who we are as a church. As we conclude the third chapter of Paul's letter this evening, I want to address the matter of what we have as a church, and we're going to see that these are closely related. Just briefly reviewing our last study, Paul tells the Corinthians that they together are the temple of God. We saw how that original term in the Greek for temple meant the inner chamber, the holy of holies, that place where God's presence was manifested. And we saw how that's true today, not in a literal structure or building, but that the Holy Spirit of God lives within our hearts. And together, God is building us into a temple where He dwells. That's our identity as a local church family. We are the dwelling place of God on earth. In the Old Testament, it was the tabernacle and then the temple. In the New Testament, it was the person of Jesus Christ. But since His ascension and the giving of the Holy Spirit, now it's us, you and I, together. We are the temple of God. The Holy Spirit lives in us and works through us. Now, in the closing verses of chapter 3, Paul moves on to what we have as a church. He'll come back to this theme that's been brought up several times already of divisions within the church there in Corinth. And he strikes to the very heart of those divisions and shows how they were missing the boat. They were really not understanding all that they had available to them. And so he first tells the Corinthians, you must reject the worldly. Secondly, you must remove the wrangling. And then finally, receive the worthy that God provides. Paul begins by instructing the Corinthians to reject the worldly. You see this in verses 18 through 20. Do not deceive yourselves. If anyone thinks he is wise by the standards of this age, he should become a fool that he might become wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness in God's sight. As it is written, he catches the wise in their craftiness. And again, the Lord knows that the thoughts of the wise are futile. He begins with the words, do not deceive yourselves. This phrase appears only six times in the New Testament, and every time it's from the Apostle Paul. This is one of his phrases that he uses time and time again. In the original, it is in the present imperative tense, which suggests that this was in fact happening. Paul is saying, stop it. Stop deceiving yourselves. And that's the worst kind of deception. It's one thing if someone else deceives you, but when you deceive yourself, you're least likely to recognize it and correct it. So Paul says, do not deceive yourself. Stop deceiving yourselves. What were they being deceived about? This whole idea of wisdom. They were chasing after the wisdom of the world. They were trying to do things the world's way, and they were being deceived. They were actually deceiving themselves. Paul is saying that true wisdom is found in renouncing the wisdom of the world. You know, a lot of division in the churches would be eliminated if people weren't so impressed with their own wisdom. A person who thinks they're wise in contemporary human wisdom does nothing but deceive himself. And Paul says here, you ought to become a fool. The Greek here is moros, so that you might become wise. Because the wisdom of the world is mere foolishness. Again, moria. We get the word moron from it. The wisdom of the world is moronic to God. Can't put it much clearer than that. And yet, so often, as Christians, we're going after the wisdom of the world. Human wisdom just doesn't cut it when it comes to spiritual things. Paul's been hammering away at this idea that the wisdom of the world is foolishness in God's sight. And to do so, he cites two Old Testament verses. The first is Job 5:13, where he says that he catches the wise in their craftiness. Now, if you go back to Job in your Bible, you'll see that the verse doesn't quite read exactly the same. It's not even exactly the Greek Septuagint version. It very well may have been Paul's own translation from the Hebrew. Sometimes we forget just how brilliant Paul was. He was an expert in the Old Testament. He knew Hebrew better than we know English. And he could translate from the Hebrew into the Greek that they spoke at that time. And that's probably what we have here in this verse. And then he quotes from Psalm 94:11. The emphasis is on the futility of human wisdom. The word there literally means fruitless. Imagine these fields that you pass by right now, and the corn is about 8 feet high. Imagine if when harvest time came, all it was were stalks, no ears of corn. All these fields of beans, they get all nice and green and they look so good, but what if come harvest time there's no beans, just stems and leaves? Some of you may have a fruit tree in your yard or maybe close by, and they may blossom and they may look so full of life, but what if they never bear fruit? It's futile. They're taking up space. There's really no point. And that's what the wisdom of the world is. It's fruitless. And we're reminded that Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches. If you abide in me, you will bear much fruit. But apart from me, you can do nothing. You are fruitless. And he goes on to say that any branch in me that doesn't bear fruit gets broken off and thrown in the fire. I'm not really sure what he means by that, but you know, you can take that as you will. Doesn't sound good. But yet, how often do we run after the things of the world? Now, when Paul is talking about wisdom here, he's not talking about areas of business or math or science or mechanics. We can be quite knowledgeable in those things without any special enlightenment from God. Some of the best mechanics I've ever known weren't Christians. Some of the most brilliant minds that you see in math and economics and science aren't necessarily Christian. He's speaking here of things spiritual. When it comes to spiritual matters, the world doesn't have a clue. And there are no authority to speak on such things. So why do we go after them? If there was a world-renowned mathematician, would you necessarily go to them and ask them a question about how to cook something? They might be brilliant in math, but they don't know a pot from a pan when it comes to the kitchen. And the same is true when it comes to spiritual things. Now, this has two practical applications. Corporately, as a church family or as a church body, it comes as a shock to some members that the local church cannot be managed the same way you run a business. Now, I'm not saying that we shouldn't use good business principles in managing a church, but the church is not a business. It is not a human organization. It is a spiritual one. It's totally different from working in a business setting. The wisdom of this world may work for the world, but it's not going to work for the church. Because the world depends on promotion, prestige, the influence of money, of important people. But the church depends on prayer, the power of the Holy Spirit, humility, sacrifice, service. Yeah. You try to bring up some of those concepts at a board meeting of a Fortune 500 company, they'll laugh you right out of the room. What are you talking about? Humility? Sacrifice? I don't think so. No, it doesn't work. Because they're talking about two completely different things. The church that imitates the world may seem to succeed in time, but it'll turn to ashes in eternity. The book of Acts had none of the secrets of success that seem to be important today. Back then, they owned no property. They had no influence in government. They really didn't have a whole lot of money. Remember what Peter said when he was asked for alms? Silver and gold I don't have, but what I do have, I'll give you. And that was the name of Jesus. And that really solved the problem. The silver and gold would not have helped all that much, maybe temporarily, but it would not have cured the man. I like how Stuart Briscoe puts that exchange. The man asked for alms and he got legs. The leaders of the early church were ordinary men. They didn't have specialized education. They didn't go to the accepted schools. Paul was an exception, but he came along later. What you see in the early chapters of the book of Acts is that these Christians impressed people because they weren't overly educated. They were the least likely to succeed, and yet God did amazing things through them. You know, they didn't hold any attendance contests, at least not that we're aware of. They didn't bring in celebrities to try to pack in the crowds, but they turned the world upside down. I'm going to be honest, and this is my personal opinion. If this was in the old days, it'd say commentary across the screen. I've never really been comfortable with the so-called church growth movement that emerged right around the time I was coming out of college. They talked about using marketing techniques, targeting certain demographics in a community. Now, those things may work in a business setting, but the underlying principles do not, in my opinion, align with Scripture. It may fill pews, but it doesn't change hearts. And I've never been comfortable with that. I think this is why you see so many churches that may be a mile wide and an inch deep. Because they're not relying on the Spirit, they're relying on marketing strategies. They're relying on powerful personalities instead of the resources of God. They're more concerned with entertaining an audience than equipping an army. They have very little interest in spiritual matters. But this also has a secondary individual level of application. We Christians do not have a right to our opinion when it comes to the things God has revealed. Now, we as Americans love our rights. And we love the right we have to our opinion. And we have an opinion about everything, right? And that's my opinion, and I have a right to it. Now, that's fine when it comes to matters of preference. You may really like something, I may really not like it, and that's fine. That's your opinion, I can have mine, and neither one of us is any better or worse. That's our opinion. But when it comes to truth, when it comes to God's revealed word, our opinion doesn't really matter. And I've been in groups of Christians And they'll read a section of the Bible and they'll say, well, I think it means this. And someone else will say, well, in my opinion, it means that. Our opinions don't change what God says. And we need to understand what God says, even if it goes against our personal opinions, even if it goes against our personal preferences. We need to understand that there are a lot of things in which we're allowed to have an opinion on. You can have your favorite flavor of ice cream, or you can have your favorite sports team, or you can have your favorite this, that, or the other, and that's fine. You can have your favorite hymns. You can have your favorite version of Scripture. That's okay. But when it comes to the truth of God's Word, we don't have the right to pick and choose. That's the way of the world. The world says you're entitled to your opinion about everything. But when it comes to God's Word, it doesn't work. Two places where you're not allowed to have an opinion, or at least your opinion doesn't matter. One is in God's Word and the other is in math class. You know, if the teacher has 2 plus 2 on the board, your opinion might be that it's 38, but your opinion doesn't matter. And in things like that, and people say, well, I have a right to my opinion. Well, yeah, you have the right to be wrong. But God's Word stands true, regardless of what we may think about it. What we need to do is be open to God's Word and let it instruct us instead of us instructing God. Doesn't that seem ridiculous? I'm going to tell God what's right. Right. But how often do we do that when we try to impose our opinions on His truth? So, first of all, we must reject the worldly way of thinking, reject the worldly way of doing things when they do not square with Scripture. Second, Paul says, remove the wrangling. In verse 21, Paul writes very simply, so then, no more boasting about men. Remember how the church was divided? They all had their favorite preacher. I like Paul. I like Apollos. I like Peter. They all had their little groups, their little cliques. And they looked down on the others. Well, you're not part of our group. What's wrong with you? And the church was terribly divided. And it's their insistence on projecting their opinions and preferences, which was really something that worldly-minded people would do, not something God's children should be doing. But it was perpetuating this division. And it was really fostering more immaturity than it was humility. Insisting on our own way is really childish. And the same is true spiritually. When we insist it's got to be done my way, we're showing how immature we really are. Exalting people just leads to disappointment, disillusionment. Eventually, it'll come to a crash, because if you're following a person, you're going to fall when they do. And trust me, they're going to fall. They're people. They're humans. They still struggle. And you'll fall right along with them. What was happening here is the Corinthians were glorying in the creation, not in the Creator. And they needed to repent of this boastful, self-centered human wisdom. They needed to start developing spiritual humility based on God's perfect truth rather than their own personal tastes. Exalting Christ as Lord rather than a human leader that was really, after all, just a servant. Paul had talked about that earlier in chapter 3. What is Paul? What is Apollos? We're just servants. And he comes back to that idea here at the end of the third chapter as well. Now, I'm not downplaying the worth of godly leaders in the church. You realize how blessed the Corinthian church was? Think of the preachers that they had. The Apostle Paul was their church founder. You know, that's amazing in and of itself. One of the greatest people in all of church history began that church. Later on, Apollos came through. What a marvelous preacher. Oh, this guy was eloquent. He was just a delight to listen to. And then, though we don't know that Peter ever came to Corinth, people either had seen Peter, maybe somewhere else, maybe they had been somewhere that Peter was and had heard him preach, or I don't know, maybe they heard him on the radio back then, you know, maybe he were, you know, getting his 8-track tapes, I don't know. Somehow, there were some who were devoted to Peter. Here are three wonderful servants of God. Tremendous individuals that God used in mighty ways. But instead of being thankful, and instead of utilizing these great resources, they were squabbling about it. They were choosing sides and putting down the others. You know, well, Paul might be great, but he doesn't preach like Apollos does. And Peter, he was one of the original ones, you know. And they try to pick at the others to exalt their own. It's like kids on the playground saying, you know, my dad can beat your dad, this, that, and the other thing. It's really what it was. Paul says, that needs to stop. Remove this wrangling from among you. Today, Christians can learn from any number of good teachers and leaders. We have resources that no other generation has ever had. Between radio and television and the internet, the written word, there is so much available to us. And I'm thankful. I thank God that we live in a time that we have such tremendous resources at our disposal. But let's not make it a point of contention. Let's not bicker and fight and look down on others because, well, you don't see things the way I do. You don't like the same authors I like. You don't read the same Bible that I read. We're missing the point. Instead of benefiting from what God has for us, we end up dividing ourselves, and we're weaker for it. The bottom line in all of this is that everything done in the church is done for the glory of God. That's our mission. That's our motive. The Corinthians had gotten their focus off of the Lord. They were on to their own preferences and on to personalities. That always leads to disharmony and disunity. I guarantee that any church that is suffering from division and strife, they've lost their spiritual focus somewhere along the line. Most of the things that congregations quarrel and squabble about won't amount to a hill of beans 100 years from now. Maybe not a year from now. But boy, it's all or nothing, and we're in it to the death. And unfortunately, what usually dies is the church, or at least the church's testimony around town. We need to remove the wrangling by fixing our focus on God. Then finally, Paul charges the Corinthians to receive the worthy. Look at the end of verse 21 down through verse 23. All things are yours, whether Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or the present or the future, all are yours, and you are of Christ, and Christ is of God. All things are yours. What in the world is Paul talking about here? One author puts it this way: God's servants are for the church, not the church for God's servants. We need to keep that perspective in mind. See, the worldly approach to leadership involves a popular, persuasive, powerful leader whose followers are always at his beck and call. In other words, all things belong to the ruler, the king, the guru. That's where all the attention is focused. Now, that might be the bylaws of a kingdom or of a cult, but that's not the way God structured his body, the church. The leaders of the church are the servants of God, and not only the servants of God, but the servants of God's people. This comes as a real shock to many, especially those behind pulpits. But pastors are to serve the people, not people serve the pastors. And yet, how many churches is that turned around? All the focus is on the pastor, the leader. It's their church. No, it's not. A true church belongs to God. It's His church. And the person who's behind the pulpit is simply a servant of God, and in serving God, they're to serve you. It turns everything around from the way the world would look at it. God has given several servants to each church, not just one. And as these servants work together and as the people appreciate all of their efforts, they're going to grow. But if we divide off into groups and segments, we're not going to grow. Anything, we're going to go backwards. And since all these ministers and ministries are given to the church, why limit yourself to any one of them? I really think that's what Paul's talking about here. The Corinthians are saying, I'm for Paul, I'm for Apollos, I'm for Peter. He's saying, no, they're all for you. God has established them for your benefit. So utilize them. And very practically speaking, this means that we can benefit from those who may not agree with every portion of doctrine with us. You may be a little more of the charismatic persuasion, but you can benefit from those who are not. Or if you're not of the charismatic persuasion, you can benefit from those who are. Doesn't mean you endorse everything that they say and believe, but you can benefit from them. You may like a certain minister's style of preaching where another puts you to sleep, but they can still benefit you when they're preaching the truth. So instead of isolating and saying, well, only what this person says am I going to listen to, you're really shorting yourself. You're shortchanging yourself. God has given us a variety of things, and He's saying, they're all yours. You know, I go back to the story of the Garden of Eden. How many of the trees of the garden were Adam and Eve allowed to eat from? All but one, right? Now, we don't know how many there were total. I'm sure there weren't just two. My guess is there was a multitude of trees bearing fruit in the garden. You are free to eat all of them. There's just one I want you to stay away from. And He was very specific about it. God created us with this marvelous ability to make choices. And there's so many things that He allows and says, I just want you to choose. I'm so glad that God created color, aren't you? And yeah, I have favorite colors. Those of you that know me know what mine are. But the truth is, I love a variety of colors. I just love to see color. It's a great diversity. There's a wide range of musical styles. I like quite a few. There's some I don't care for. My guess is if you knew mine, you probably wouldn't care for some of mine. That's all right. But we can enjoy these. God has given us great freedom. Some look at the Bible and say, if God didn't say I can do it, I can't. I look at the Bible and say, unless God said I can't do it, I can. Because God has created us to be free. He has given us such great resources. You know, it's not just Paul and Apollos and Peter that are for benefiting the church. He says everything. The world, life, death, things present, things future. All are yours. This is what you have as a church. God has given you so much. Enjoy it. benefit from it, grow by it. Romans 8:17 says we are heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. And he ends this passage by saying, you are of Christ and Christ is of God. I think that balances this whole statement out. We've got to be careful that we don't let our liberty become license. All things are yours, that's our liberty. You are of Christ, that's our responsibility. So we don't completely get out of control. We belong to him. He doesn't belong to us. We are his possession. He is not our possession. He purchased us by his blood. We are his treasure. He is our Lord. Now that sounds like foolishness to the world, but to believers living by the Spirit, this is God's wisdom. And I wonder, why don't we live like it? Why do we always seem to be so impoverished spiritually? I think that there's an old saying that we fail to possess our possessions. Like the Israelites who were given the promised land and God said, I will give you every place you set your foot. And yet generation after generation, well, they failed to eradicate all of the enemies of God from this land. Why? Did God fail them? Absolutely not. They had all the resources needed. They just didn't use them. My guess is they got complacent. They got lazy. They said, ah, good enough. We don't have to do any more. Good enough. That's often the enemy of the best. But they had everything they needed. We're promised in 2 Peter 1, verse 3, his divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness. Sounds like Paul's words here in 1 Corinthians, doesn't it? All things are yours. And yet we so often live in spiritual defeat and disillusionment. I think it's because too often we're trying to use the world's way of success. We're trying to use the world's ideas and resources instead of God's. If we would do things God's way with God's resources, we'll succeed. If not, we probably won't. Max Lucado, in his book, Come Thirsty, he illustrates this point in a creative chapter that's called Hope for Tuckered Town. I'd like to share an extended portion of this story. Turn north at Stress Village, drive a few miles east of Worryville, bear right at the fork leading to Worn Out Valley, and you'll find yourself entering the weary streets of Tuckered Town. Her residents live up to the name. They lumber like pack mules on a Pike's Peak climb, eyes down, faces long, shoulders slump. Ask them to explain their sluggish ways, and they point to their cars. You'd be tired, too, if you had to push one of these. And to your amazement, that's what they do. Shoulders pressing, feet digging, legs, lungs puffing, they muscle automobiles up and down the street. Rather than sit behind the wheel, they lean into the trunk. The sight puzzles you. The sound stuns you. Do you hear what you think you hear? Yeah, you're hearing the engines running. Citizens of Tuckered Town, turn the key, start the car, slip it into neutral, and push. You ask someone why. A young mother rolls her minivan into the grocery store parking lot. Ever thought of pressing the gas, you ask? I do, she replies, brushing sweat away. I press the gas to start the car, and then I take over. A bizarre answer. But no more bizarre than that of the out-of-breath fellow leaning against his 18-wheeler, wheezing like an overweight marathoner. Did you push this truck, you ask? I did, he gasps, covering his mouth with an oxygen mask. Why not use the accelerator? He cocks an eyebrow. Because I'm a Tucker trucker, and we're strong enough to do our own work. It doesn't look strong to you, but you say nothing. You just walk away wondering, what kind of people are these? A pedal push away from power, and yet they ignore it. Who would live like that? Paul asked the Galatian church the identical question. You began your life in Christ by the Spirit. Now you're trying to make it complete by your own power? That's foolish. Same word is, that's moronic. Is God nothing more than a jumper cable? Startup strength and nothing more? Corinthian Christians pushed a few cars too. You're still not spiritual, the apostle accused. What are you saying, Paul? Are they saved? Yes. He addresses them as brothers and sisters. He considers them to be God's children, heaven-bound, saved but not spiritual, plugged in but not flipped on. Brothers and sisters, I had to talk to you as people without the Spirit, babies in Christ. You're still not spiritual because there's jealousy and quarreling among you, and this shows that you're not spiritual. You're acting like people of the world. I used to think there were two kinds of people, the saved and the unsaved. Paul corrects me by describing a third, the saved but unspiritual. The spiritual person is Spirit-dependent, Spirit-directed, Spirit-dominated. He seeks to walk in the Spirit. Conversely, the unspiritual person cranks the car and hunkers behind it. Tragically, these people act like people of the world. In language, lifestyle, priorities, personality, they blend in with non-believers. They let God save them, but not change them. Such carnal Christianity frustrated Paul. You began life in Christ by the Spirit. Now you're trying to make it on your own power? Foolish and miserable. You don't want to carpool with unspiritual Christians. They have no kind words to share. There is jealousy and strife among them. The only joy they know graduated from high school last year. And gratitude? Gratitude for what? The two-ton Hummer that daily has to be pushed uphill? The saved but unspiritual see salvation the way a farmer sees 100 acres of untilled soil. Lots of work. Church attendance, sin resistance. Have I done enough? It's no wonder they're tired. No wonder they argue. You're jealous of one another. You quarrel with each other. Doesn't that prove you're controlled by your own desires? Harsh words, joyless days, contentious relationships, thirsty hearts. There's more excitement than you'll find more excitement at an Amish prom. Max wrote those words, I didn't. Who wants to live in Tuckered Town? Moreover, who wants to move there? Nothing repels non-Christians more than gloomy Christians. No one wants a free truck if you have to push it. Your neighbor doesn't. Quite honestly, you don't. And God doesn't want it for any of us. His word for tuckered out Christians, as you received Christ Jesus the Lord, so continue to live in Him. How do you receive Christ? By grace through faith. How do you live in Christ? By grace through faith. When you do, saving power becomes staying power. God, who began a good work in you, will continue His work until it's finally finished on the day when Christ comes back again. Christ did not give you a car and then tell you to push it. He didn't even give you a car and tell you to drive it. You know what He did? He threw open the passenger door, invited you to take a seat, and told you to buckle up for the adventure of your life. That's what it means to be a Christian. That's what we have as a church. We have the resources of Almighty God to get us through every day, to help us make good decisions, help us avoid costly temptations and sins and wrong decisions, to do what only God can do through us. This is what we have as a church. All the resources of Almighty God, purchased by Christ, supplied by the Spirit who lives in each one of us. To rely on a human leader or even ourselves is like one of those worn-out citizens of Tuckered Town pushing our cars that are capable of being driven. We need a healthy biblical understanding of the church. We must not divide the church in terms of its leaders. We need to define leaders in terms of the church. We must renounce secular views of the church as a merely human institution, like any other corporate body, with human leaders wielding human authority, being lionized as celebrities. That has to go. In their place, we need to develop a godly view of the church as a unique community unlike any other. the redeemed and covenant people of God. And in this community, the ministers serve. They're not served. There's no boasting about human beings. All boasting is directed to God. So no more boasting about men, but rather let him who boasts boast in the Lord. This is what we have as a church. It's just a matter if we're going to start living like it and utilizing what God has given us. Will you bow with me as we close tonight in prayer? Father, we thank you for all that you give us, all of the blessings, the human servants that you bring in with their various talents that you have given them, the spiritual gifts they exercise, not for their own benefit, but for ours. You have given us so much, and we use so little. We try to do it ourselves. We limit ourselves to only those people that we like or agree with, that meet our tastes and preferences. Father, I pray that you would open our eyes to the abundant resources we have so that we might live lives that please you, that together as a church, we might really have an impact on our culture using the resources you have given us. Forgive us for being too much like the world, thinking that imitating the world will draw them to us, when in fact, we need to give them a clear alternative to what they're already living in. So go with us now. Open our minds to what you have for us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.